Her husband messed up her mic, so she decided to say no to slides. It's hard to kind of imagine her hating anything, right? Naturally, as you love people and you want to serve them, you start needing more hands in your office to be able to do that. And I've been fortunate enough to have a couple of amazing associates. And, you know, I'm not a huge, like, super great entrepreneurial type of person, but I've just gotten really lucky. And I love seeing on the ICPA member page how many offices are looking for more associates, their practice is growing, they're looking for more and more people to join them and be a part of it, and I think that's so amazingly special. And a couple years ago, I was out at Mile High, the chiropractic conference in Denver, and I got to hear our next speaker, and I immediately, like halfway through the presentation, I picked up my phone, I texted Justin, I said, we need to get her on an ICPA stage. I just was riveted by her professionalism and, I mean, pardon my French, that like boss bitch attitude about like serving chiropractic. And she has built the type of practice with associates and people to serve others in the way that we all hope to do so. She also now teaches other chiropractors how to do just that. Please welcome Dr. Elise Rigney.
Because my eyes, like, am I getting old? I think it's babies relaxing. It messes up your eyes and your feet. Like, your feet are never the same size again, right? If you know, you know. Well, thank you guys. Thanks for having me. So I like to kind of, if you've listened to me before in any capacity, you know, like, kind of the boss, whatever we want to, language we want to use, I just like to get straight to the point and, like, treat this kind of like a training because my big thing is like takeaways. And what I've kind of didn't realize I started to become known for was building a team of chiropractors. I had no plan of ever teaching anyone, any chiropractor, anything, except the chiropractors in my office. And then once we started to see, or once other chiropractors started to see what we were doing, they were like, this is different. I've never seen multiple chiropractors in a practice, and your patients see everyone. They don't just get scheduled under one chiropractor. And I set pretty high expectations in my office, and it's been really natural for chiropractors to want to come and work with us. So I started teaching just how to have multiple docs in an office and have that consistency and be able to replicate results within your office. And so that's what I'm here to talk about today. So I have my team here. And this photo is actually a couple years old, and I was about to take it out, but I'm like, you know what's kind of cool? It's a couple years old. I don't really look like that right now, but all those docs are still with me. And I think that speaks volumes too. And what's pretty neat is we've got Dr. Heather on the left, who just became CACCP certified like 2 weeks ago. And then, yes, and Dr. Courtney in the middle, she just submitted her CACCP exam and is really praying she's passing the first time, because I passed the first time and I was not valedictorian in my class, but Dr. Laura on the right was valedictorian and didn't pass the first time. So there's a little bit of competition happening in the office, but Dr. Laura actually just opened up. So she's been working with me since she was a student at Palmer, and then she went on to become our senior associate doctor in the office and then open up our second location, which we partnered on, Impact Chiropractic. So this is my favorite quote, and it feels like it keeps coming up again and again in a theme this weekend as well. But if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And this resonates with me significantly, because when I started my practice, I was like, I'm going to see 1,000 patients a week. I'm going to have a high volume practice. Like, I can do this. I saw this doc on stage. They said they did this. And it was like, that's just, I'm an Enneagram 3 achiever. Let's go. And I was like, wow, did I get knocked on my feet with my physical health, with my adrenals, and to a point where I actually could not adjust. I was in so much chronic pain that actually was a beautiful injury that caused me to move forward to create what we have now, and has allowed all of our chiropractors to go on amazing maternity leaves. It has opened up so that we don't have to close the office. Our patients can always receive care because there's so many of us to be able to take care of them, but then we can all go and we can recharge and we can reset and we can rejuvenate and do what we need to do to show up the best to serve our people. Now, like I said, there's high expectations in my office, which you can see, like, they know from the beginning. First of all, it's all signed off. If anyone's worked with me, you know, like, I'm like, it's signed off, so we agree upon everything in the beginning. And one of those agreements is that you become CACCP certified within 2 years. Everyone's Webster certified before they even touch a patient in our practice as well. But I'm going to talk about some of the consistency or the techniques that we use to make sure that the care that we are offering within our office has similarities and consistency between it for the sake of the patient. So I claim to know nothing as far as, like, I can't remember language from technique classes or anything like it. So I'm going to talk to you like I talk to our doctors. And we train with our doctors 60 to 90 minutes every single week. Usually two of those trainings a month are hands-on trainings where we are making sure our touch feels similar. So we're going through, and when we're going through the 6 points of Webster, we want to make sure piriform is sweeping or swiping, whatever word you want to use, Pam, you can tell me, is not like one's doing like an elbow piriform, like, dear God, I hope no one does that to a pregnant woman, but you know, one's not just doing a quick little swipe. We want to make sure we've got that tone consistent, and we've trained and trained and trained on patients or our team members to make sure that we have that consistency between all of us, because I actually saw recently on like an Instagram photo of a doctor who was doing Webster, and they were doing psoas with like the mama's knee like up here on his shoulder. And I was like, oh, well, that's a way to do it. I don't know. That's not how I do it, but that's a way to do it. But then I was thinking, man, when he brings other doctors into his office, he's gonna need to make sure either he teaches that doctor that way of doing psoas, or else that doctor is able to have a conversation with the mamas and say, I know Dr. So-and-so usually puts your leg up here, but he's 6'5", and I'm 5'2". So we still have the same goal in mind, but this is going to look a little bit different. And that might not seem like a really big deal right now to talk about, but it is a big deal to your patients. So we're going to go through these three artful tips. The first is rituals and bookending. Oh, you guys, these are my kids in the pictures. So I have Stella and then Sloan. So Sloan's in the middle. She's starting second grade Monday. And you can just see she's a Cairo kiddo because, like, look at the spark in her eye. And then Ford is all the way down. He was my March 2020 pandemic baby. So first thing, rituals and bookending is what we're going to talk about first. Rituals, if you think of what your rituals are anyways in your day-to-day, Dr. Peter mentioned that on the panel last night. Like, what do you do to refill? What's a ritual that you do every day in your life? We have rituals in our office that we may not be aware of. So as I speak, even if what I do, you don't do, and you're like, whatever, think about what you do, because the way I see that we're going to make the greatest impact is if we continue to mentor chiropractors who are in our office, who we meet, that we continue to teach and, like, download the knowledge we have to those docs. And continue to train along the way, too, and teach things that are not as obvious. Rituals is one thing that's not as obvious, and then bookending. So bookending is what you should do when you speak. If you've taken any public speaking classes, they'll tell you to bookend your talk, your opening and your end. Well, this we should do in every visit in the office. So what do you do at the beginning? And I'm not talking about, like, day one, day two, anything like that. At the beginning of just a standard visit with a patient, and you have to think of all different patients, right? We have to think of, like, the general adult and then baby and what age of baby versus teen versus pregnant mama or pregnant person, I should say. And what do you do at the beginning of that visit that is consistent every single time? And I'll tell you what we do. Most of our patients are laying face down, not usually our mamas in the pregnancy pillows unless they're like, oh, thank God, I finally get to lay face down. They might get themselves ready, but typically not, but everyone else is. And when we come up, we have a certain position that we put our hands on every single patient because there's 5-6 of us, 5 in one office now, where we want to make sure we have that same consistent positioning that we place. So there's something you do before you adjust that is the beginning, part of the bookending, so document what that is because you're going to want to teach that to anyone else who's coming in to care for your people. So bookending between I gotta switch to the next slide. We'll come back to more of that. But the rituals, and bookending here. So rituals, kind of like I mentioned, but they're consistent and predictable. So you have rituals in your office too, if you don't, you might not even realize it. Maybe when patients come in, they take off their shoes, or there might be something consistent that they're doing on their way in and their way out. But it's something that allows patients to feel at home. And they rely on it. So like I mentioned with our adjustments, we've got a specific hand placement. And this might sound so silly, but we will literally have one of our team members on the table during doctor's training, and we'll go this, and then we'll say, tell us what you noticed that was different. And it's lay people's terms, which is excellent, because that's how I speak anyways. And we're able to, some of us have huge hands. Dr. Amy's 6'3", some of us have bony hands, some of us have tiny hands. Like, how can we get, even though we're all different human beings, to have some sort of consistency and intention? We train on the intention too when we first place our hands on that patient. Make sure we are fully there. So, and I put on there, sometimes you'll hear of like a 5-second stretch or something where you have that same timing too. And then afterwards, how do you bookend that adjustment? What is that final touch? I know, like, when I get a massage, my massage therapist always has like this like back rub she does and like a tap. I'm like, oh, it's done. Okay, all right. But what is your final, like, how are you closing out with each patient? And it's going to look different, of course, like the way that you're ending with certain patients versus others. They might be on their back. They might be on their side. You might be helping your mamas or your pregnant people get up. But think about what that bookend looks like and how you can create that into a ritual. All right, before the doctor's report, these are some rituals that we do and we train on. So making sure that we set an intention before we go in. I'm really, really, really big on not winging a doctor's report. I used to work in offices. I was a CA before becoming a chiropractor too, where the doctor would literally grab the file and be like, okay, going in. Bob, okay. Hey, Bob, how you doing? And it's like, why'd they fill out paperwork? Why'd we take a history the first time they were in if we're not going to review it and know every single thing, like almost stalk them to a point, so you're like, I know you, I know what you need, right? But you, when you set that intention, you want to already be visualizing that patient on the table. Like, they've signed up for care. They're ready. They're on the table. This is how their visit goes. Just start to close your eyes and think your way through that, too, before you even go straight in with them. So like I said, knowing everything about them and taking that minute to breathe and visualize. We don't wing anything. We don't wing anything. That's why we train really hard. We train for worst case scenarios too, because a patient's life is on the line. And that's what we need to remember at the end of the day. If we're there and we're sloppy and we're bringing in our personal stuff and we're not putting our intention and our mind on the person in front of us, we need to call ourselves out and figure out, and this is what's great about having multiple docs in your office. Sometimes crap is going on, like serious stuff is going on. And we're able to tap in and tap out and be like, I'm not my best self right now. And I will say, like, that is, I've always been a team sport athlete, and that is the best thing about having other docs in your office is that ability to have each other rely on each other and support each other. And I will say, just because I'm the owner, I don't know everything. I need to call them in for different things all the time, and it's just such a beautiful place to be able to do that. Before a new patient, we've got, like, this confident walk down the, like, however you want it to look, but, you know, you're like, I got this, I'm going in, I'm ready. Hi, nice to meet you, I'm Dr. Elise. Eye contact, right there, square shoulders, right in. You gotta practice that, and you gotta, like, feel, like, what's your walk? Everyone's walk is different, but what is that walk to be, like, putting everything else aside? I'm going, Sarah's in front of me now. So that confident walk, this might sound silly, you guys, but I'm telling you, it sets the tone. It sets the tone. Whatever it is that's that ritual for you before you go in with a new patient, teach that to your other docs in your office. Okay, adjustments for all is the second tip I wanted to go through. So adjustments for all types of people. How do you modify? So this is my question for you. How do you modify your adjustment dependent on the person on your table? And there's so many modifications that go on, right? We've got you'll be able to kind of generalize and create a methodology, how do you say that word, for each person. Like, we can say Webster. We've got the steps of Webster, right? When do we have to call an audible? We got to train on that with all of us docs so that we know when audibles need to be called with different cases that show up, different situations that happen. patient's going through something that no one could have even anticipated, what does that audible look like? What's the communication around that? Because even in Dr. Jen's course, we need to be able to role play. A mama comes in who's experienced loss. If we've taken a course, but we haven't trained on it with each other, especially young docs coming straight out of school, they're gonna feel much more comfortable if they've had some sort of training where we can role play that and be able to have the best responses or empathy or just be able to talk it through together before we come out of that and felt unprepared for that too. So modifying adjustments, I'm off track, I keep going on my tangents, but pediatric adjustments depending on ages, depending on assessment, there's so much with this. So go back to techniques that you're using in your office, assessment tools that you're using in your office, and then the skills that you've developed. So many people, you're like, what technique do you practice? And they're like, oh, Dr. Elise technique. And it's like, cool, that's really cool, but are you able to teach that to others? And some of you guys are phenomenal at teaching technique to others, but I would say start to whatever is happening in your office. If you want any moment to just have some freedom in your office and allow others to have freedom and be able to leave the office and know that everyone's able to stay on their care plan and have phenomenal care, then downloading this information now is going to help future generations of chiropractors for years to come. It's all about sharing that wealth of knowledge. Couple of other things, like if we have extremity, random extras, things that we don't normally do, how do we know when to do them, what to do, and then how to document them? So that's something really important too. If something happened with a patient in the adjustment room or on the table, and it was different than what you'd normally do, where are you documenting that? Because sometimes we're a high volume office and we sometimes don't see each other till the end of the day. You don't remember anything, and platinum takes everyone's name off of there. So it's not like you can go back and be like, oh, let me talk to you about this person. We've got some systems with Slack and stuff, but we want to make sure we're documenting in their note exactly what we did and why, and have a place where other doctors are able to see that. So when they come in with that patient the next time, they're able to see, oh, I saw that Dr. Heather did a diaphragm release on you. How are you doing after that? They can follow up on it. And that's the way we have collaboration in the office too, but you've got to have like those sneaky ways to communicate with each other too, just in case you forget to actually talk as well. No, this is a rule for us. So we're all kind of nerds and like to go to seminars and learn new things, but we have an agreement between all of us that no doctor pulls out a new adjustment without discussing, agreeing, and training on it with the other doctors. So that's something that is very important because that can create a hierarchy. And I see the hierarchy usually with owners in practice. So my goal is to avoid where the owner is like the god of the practice, right? And then everyone else below is a minion and just an associate. That is like the oldest school model that I cannot stand. We are all doctors. We are all doctors. And yes, we might need to do some training to get on the same level as far as the skill sets that we need to develop over time, AKA everyone becomes CACCP certified in my office, but we're all still doctors, and within the community's eyes, a doctor is a doctor is a doctor, right? So all the tools that we've learned, though, we can have some really cool ones, but I don't want one doc pulling out some BGI, phenomenal, right? And none of us know it, and then that patient comes back and is like, oh, Dr. Amy did this weird thing, but, and you're like, uh-huh, uh-huh. I don't know what the F that was. I'm gonna have to go talk to her. What did you do? She's like, oh, I'm so sorry. I just like was in the moment and I know she needed it. So we just have that rule, like if we know a patient needs something, we go back and train on it and we all agree upon it and we make sure we all feel confident in it and then we integrate it into the practice. It's not very difficult, but these are little things that if we don't think about, create bigger problems within the office. Okay, this is our doctor's checklist. So I'll show you on the next slide, I believe, or maybe two slides over, what the actual training checklist is composed of. But when a doctor's hired in our office, the first 90 days is a probationary period. The next 6 months is a training period. And this is just one tiny, tiny section of some of the art or the technique part that we want to make sure we're all on the same page with. So sacral, pelvic drop, correction, analysis and lumbar adjustments, TL specialty prone, and then TL specialty supine, scoliosis corrective adjustments, CT adjustments, rib adjustments, posterior and anterior, C-spine correction, toggle, occiput lift, occipital supine, C-drops, extremity adjustments, shoulder impingement, shoulder, scapular, ribs, anterior, radial head adjustment, carpals, long axis distraction, ears and sinuses, TMJ, lateral pterygoids, activator adjusting, when we bring that in, what that looks like in the assessment, Logan Basic, pediatric adjusting has its own checklist. Cranial work, we have suicidal, mental illness, grief, parasympathetic work, and tongue tie, lip tie, intraoral work, intraoral eustachian tube work, and then with our Webster technique and prenatal extras, assessment with sacral drop, piriformis swiping, sacrotuberous assessment, and Logan Basic, pubic symphysis adjusting, psoas testing, muscle work, round ligament assessment, diaphragm release, quote-unquote induction technique, kidney lift, dural release, Carol Phillips work, spinning babies, three sisters, referrals and all of them on there, prenatal recommendations, because we want to make sure our recommendations are consistent too when we're talking to mamas. And then our checklist is about, that's probably about 10% of the checklist when an associate comes into the office of what we're trained on, but the column is that the first column on the left is what they are trained on. The middle column, they get signed off on that, they role played on that. And then the third column is that they mastered it. So by the nine months of being in our office, that's when they're actually signing on to an official contract as an impact doctor. This whole checklist is completed, as well as some KPIs that are hit that need to be met at that point too. Yeah, it's a lot to work in my office, but I tell you, it's certainly worth it. Thank you. The last one is protect your energy. And this is something that I just want to encourage you to teach other doctors, especially when you're coming straight out of school, when you're in with a mama, or when you're in with someone who's experienced loss, and then you go into the next room, and someone's exciting and expected, and then you go, expecting, and then you go into the next room, and the next table is someone who's just been sick, and is, oh, you know, negative, and upset, and all of this stuff, and it's like, how do you not carry one thing into the next room? What are those techniques you use? Being aware of your energy, how to reset, how to shield yourself, and then teaching them how to practice personal grounding techniques, especially when it is high volume and you're going from room to room, person to person, how to put shields, energetic shields on you. Maybe it's an essential oil, whatever that grounding technique is. I'm sorry, I don't have enough time, but practicing emotional technique, you can teach cord cutting as well to your team. And then lastly, I have a free mini training. This is pretty basic, I would say. It's 42 minutes. Those are the topics that are discussed, but it's really, really, really good for new doctors. So it's teaching some things we just don't learn, like active listening, permission, how to ask for permission with patients with babies, effective digging, metaphors and proverbs, sticky values, role fluidity, and then like we talked about today, rituals, and then foresighting as well, I didn't talk about. There's just so much to all of this, so I'm around all night, and I'm excited to hang out with you guys. If you want to chat about anything, if anything popped up for you that you have questions on or want to strategize on, I'm here for you. I'm also on Instagram. Would love to connect. Feel free to send me a DM on there, but thank you guys so much for having me.
My first day in chiropractic.